foot. Zoom, and he's out of here. That poor thing. He misses. Oh, I forgot to mention. I don't have a cat anymore. Both cats are gone. The first kitty. Oh, by the way, good morning. The first kitty that was called Special K. That was a little kitty that was dumped off at my house. That kitty just disappeared. Don't know whatever happened to it. I think it just decided it was time to go and marched on. Cats out in the country generally do that. They just decide where they want to go, when they want to do it, and I don't try and stop them. And then the second one, the one I call Pirate, that had one eye, that was the black cat, by the way. That cat was, it stayed around after little kitty left, and then slowly wasn't coming around as much for its food. It would just come around once in a great while, get some food, and then for the last 2 weeks or so or something like that, hasn't been around. That's just how it goes. I have no idea why, but Rascal sure did miss chasing him around. And you're wet. We've been having rain for the last, I think, 3 days. It's been really crazy. And it's just not really floody, but it's kind of inconvenient, and it's a little bit cool. And I'm trying to harden off my plants, by the way, because it's time to get them out into the garden. But before I take them from inside to the garden, I have to harden them off. And what hardening off just means is that you get them acclimated to the outdoor environment. Outdoor environment has stronger wind, stronger sun. Basically, it's more everything than what you have indoors. So you got to slowly get them used to the outdoor environment. And that can be a little bit stressful for your plants and a little stressful for yourself. So the best way that I have found for my plants, what works best for me, is I bring them out, start them out with about a half an hour of shade, and then take them back in. And what I mean by take them back in is I take them into either the hallway in the basement, or I put them in the red shed here. And then the next day I give them a little bit more shade, like about an hour, and then I give them a little bit of direct sunlight in the morning, and I gradually get them acclimated to the outdoor environments. And but the problem is, I started doing that. I mean, it was wonderful weather. I started doing that, and then it got windy and it was raining, and these poor plants were wondering if it was the end of days. So I've been having them in this shed more often than not, because we actually had two tornadoes touch down. I think it was just southeast of us just a couple days ago, not very far from me. Southeast of us, about maybe a half an hour. Yeah, that wasn't very far away, and it got really windy. It was kind of scary here. And also, Atlantic, which is the next town of any size at all. It's not a big town, but it's the biggest around here. Hey, you're wet. Check for mice. He always checks for mice too. And he finds them too. But it was crazy. And we went to Atlantic to go grab something to eat the next day. And this huge, huge pine tree had snapped off at ground level in a cemetery. And it went bam, and it just flattened out all these headstones. It was really kind of sad. But yeah, it was all over the darn place. But the poor animals, they were huddled up in the chicken coop. And then today, I go out there right before I turn on the camera to this. Hi, how you doing? Show them your wet self. Keeping America safe from mice. Get your mouse. Where is it? Could be anywhere. But I forgot what I was. Oh yeah, so I'm going out and I'm feeding the animals this morning, and I have my lights in there, two lights in there, so that there's always light in the coop during the day in case the chickens want to wander around. I know I don't really have to do it because they can come outside, but I spoil my birds just a little bit. So anyway, I go in there and the light's not on yet because it was really early this morning. It's actually only 6:30 in the morning right now, so I went out there at about 5:30 to 6, and it was still kind of dark. And the light hadn't turned itself on. I got it on a timer. So I went over and I'm fumbling around and I go click, and I turned on the light. I bypassed the timer. I looked down and there's a possum. Yeah, you've heard that there's possums around, but I haven't seen the possums in a few weeks. Basically, the possums and the kitties have all gone bye-bye and done their spring thing. And I figured the mama probably has babies somewhere. Anyway, I'm looking down and this possum's eating out of the trough, the corn and sunflower seeds that I feed the animals. And I'm right in front of the possum. The possum looks at me and he's like, "What are you doing?" And I look down at it and I go, "What the hell are you doing?" And it just kind of ran to the corner, but it couldn't get away. It has to go by me in order to get out this front door. So it was trapped in there. And it's running around, trying to figure out what to do. And I just went ahead and started feeding the animals. And finally, it stopped. and it just watched me. It was just kind of watching me feed the animals and feed the, you know, like I'm not going to hurt it. I don't know if it's one of my possums or just some other possum. They're all over the place around here. But anyway, after a while, it was just watching me. And so I took off and went right back to the trough. I looked in the window in the door and went right back to the trough and started eating. So that was kind of cool. Anyway, enough about possums. I wanted to come outside today and show you something, because and I wanted to come out early. That's why it's so early in the morning, because it's supposed to rain at 8 o'clock. Yeah, more rain. That's what we really need around here. Rain just tends to get everything growing. And I showed a picture. I don't know if I showed a picture on one of the episodes earlier. Showed all the dandelions everywhere. Well, those dandelions went to seed. So I have all these white puffy things everywhere, and I'm just waiting to hit it with the mower so I can spread the dandelions even more. You know, if I lived in town, I would probably be shot by homeowners who don't want their lawns to be full of dandelions, because I promote dandelions. I love dandelions. Dandelions, I know, everybody keeps telling me to eat them, but I'm not going to eat my yard. It's just what I choose not to do. I'm not going to eat my yard. So I leave that to all the birds and everything else that wants to come around and munch, because I got a lot of bunnies out here. Not the kind that go into my garden for some reason. They have no interest in my garden because I have a lot of good stuff out in my yard for them to eat. And that's what brings me to what I wanted to mention today. Actually, I don't want to stand here and do it. Let's go over there where there's no breeze. There's a breeze coming along here. I want to be over here where there's no breeze, okay? Hey, Rascal, let's go sit over here. Okay. There we go. Happy? It's a morning thing. Every morning I come out here and I fill up this water bowl, because the turkeys, they like the feel of water on their feet. That's something you may not know about turkeys. Turkeys love standing in a water bowl. Only problem is turkeys have these big old cankles, these big fat feet and big fat legs, and they're heavy, you know, they're turkeys. And they like to stand in the water, and then when they walk out, because it feels good on their feet, and it also cleans their feet. So when they start walking out of the water bowl, they walk on the edge and it goes flip, and all the water comes flying out. So I have to keep refilling this every day. Uh-oh, there's a bird. What is it? Is it birdie? Rascal, where's the bird? You're so busy. He really is. He loves summertime. Summertime is when all the birds are out. He doesn't like anything, and he doesn't want it in his yard. Sniff, sniff, sniff. Yeah, keep me safe. But yeah, they're knocking the water bowl over, so I got to fill it up. But it keeps their water fresh. But what I was getting back to, the bunnies, back when I lived in Windham, Minnesota, I had a smaller property by far, and I had less than an acre, and I had squirrel problems. But people are asking me questions about how to keep pests out of their gardens. Well, one of the questions was about squirrels. Somebody said, Ray, how do I keep squirrels out of my garden? And I give an answer that's... I give an answer that's a little bit different than most folks. I look at it from a different perspective, I guess. And my way wasn't trying to fence them out, trying to block them out, trying to shoot them or anything like that. That's not how I did it. What I thought of is, why are they doing this? And they're doing it because they're hungry. Squirrels are hungry. You know, they go after food. So I thought, well, what if I fed the squirrels and then they wouldn't be hungry and they wouldn't go into my garden? How would that work? Worked fine. So what I did was I got a 50-pound bag of crack corn, because I was feeding my chickens anyway. So I got a 50-pound bag of crack corn, which only cost me a few dollars, so it lasted forever. And I filled the bird feeder with it, because squirrels love to go to bird feeders because they know that that's a food source. And tolerate it. You just got to tolerate the turkeys. So anyway, but I put the bird feeder on the opposite side of my yard. So the squirrels would go over there and fill up on corn. I know it's probably not the most nutritious thing for them, but then again, I wasn't looking to give them the most nutritious thing. I was looking to protect my garden. And so they would go over there and hang out at the bird feeder and fill up on cracked corn, and they didn't think about the garden. And also, they made their nests over there in the big trees over where the bird feeder was, so their family could be raised over there. So that was my way of getting squirrels out of the garden, and that's what I tell people. Feed them on the opposite side of your property, and it keeps them away from your garden. It doesn't work every time, but it worked for me, and it worked for a few other people that tried it. Now, when it comes to rabbits, I was mentioning rabbits as I was coming over here. I have rabbits on my property. There's no way to keep them away. I could shoot them, but I don't want to kill them. That's just not my way. And so I wanted to figure out, how am I going to keep them out of my garden? Well, what I do is I don't know if this is what's working, but this is my practice. What I do is I keep my lawn full of all kinds of good stuff. It's got clover, it's got weeds, it's got thistle, it's got grass, it's got, you know, it's got everything. It's got all the good stuff that rabbits like to eat. And I don't keep my lawn mowed down or poisoned or chemicalized or anything like that. So it's perfectly safe for rabbits, and rabbits are filling up on that. And my garden is kind of fenced in, so rabbits go for the easy meal. You know, they don't go into my garden because it's kind of a pain in the butt to try and get over the fence. They can just be out on the lawn and eating that. And plus, my garden is close to my house, so they don't feel as comfortable coming close to my house. That's how I keep the rabbits at bay. I feed them. And that's my way of balance, because if you take away the balance, something's always going to go wrong. Somebody asked me on the compost episode. He said, Ray, can I grow my plants in pure compost? And I've gotten that question more than a few times. That's a very, very common question whenever I talk about compost. People ask me if they can grow in pure compost. Well, that's taking the balance away from things. You know, when you take the balance away from things, you tend to have problems. And although my compost is rich, it's a really good thing. It's a complement to the soil. You know, soil and compost make a good combination. It's a synergistic thing. They both help each other out, and I grow a good garden off of that. I wouldn't grow as good of a garden off of pure compost because it doesn't have all the things that soil has, and soil doesn't have all the things that compost has. And people are always looking for, I'm not blaming the people, I'm just telling you that some people are looking for the best way, and they figure that if they go to one extreme, it's going to get like that. No, it's not. So I tell the people, balance is the best for everything. Everything tries to find a balance, whether if you try to grow, whether it's too dry, too moist, too windy, all of those things, all of those extremes are bad for growing a lot of things. So you try to find a blend to where things are combined. I don't know if I'm explaining this right. So compost makes a good complement, but growing in pure compost, I think you're going to run into problems. I've never had, if I had too much compost, my plants get all crazy and they grow really big and stuff, but that's not necessarily what I want. I want a healthy plant. And a healthy plant is not necessarily the plant that grows the biggest and looks the most perfect, okay? I've grown big plants with big leaves and stuff and they look really great, but they didn't produce a lot. You want a balance of everything, and that's what it's all about, is getting the balance on it. But, I just wanted to mention that, because that was a question coming out of the compost episode. But I want to show you something. This is early spring for me. This is actually way before, I think the last frost date for around here is May 9th. And this is the end of April. This is the last couple days of April. And I already have my garden planted. I went out and I planted it. And I didn't film it because I didn't want to actually film me putting seeds in the ground. That really wasn't what I wanted to do in the way of gardening episodes. I want to show you how I grow things, but some things are for myself. So you're not going to see every single thing, but I'm going to show you as much as I possibly can. Early spring is the time that you want to get in your cold, if you have cold weather. Okay. You want to get in your cold weather stuff, like radishes, lettuces, spinach, greens like brassicas and stuff like that. They can take the cool weather, and you can actually plant them before your last frost. You just cover them up with soil and they start growing. Corn is one of the things you want to definitely wait for warmer soil temperatures, because it germinates better in warmer soil. So getting an early start on corn probably isn't your best thing, but right about now, a lot of people are getting their, if you ordered strawberry roots, you're getting in your strawberry roots, or if you ordered trees, you're getting in your bare root stock. Well, I planted my bare root stock trees, but I also planted my strawberries. They came in kind of early, and also your potatoes come in. But let me show you how I plant my strawberries. More than likely, your strawberries are going to come in a plastic bag like this, and they'll be bundled together with a string or a rubber band, and they don't look very impressive, do they? No, they don't. This is generally what your strawberry plants are going to look like. Probably just barely growing, if at all. Sometimes you won't see anything growing because these are in hibernation. And that's a good thing. You want them in hibernation. You don't want really great growing plants, because you want them to come out of hibernation in the soil. And that way they adapt a lot better that way. They're going to look really dried out and really crappy. Don't be fooled, they're not dead. All the energy is stored in these roots, and that'll get it a good start. Let's set these aside, and I'm going to show you the quickest, easiest, most successful way to plant your strawberries. Get the big clods out of your way. I just threw some dirt in today. These are the different parts of the strawberry. Right here at this line, above it we have what's called the crown. Below it we have the roots. This is a stem from last year. This doesn't need to be there, but you can leave it on there. Don't worry about it at all. And this is the new growth. You want to plant it from the bottom of the crown down. You never, ever, ever want to bury this crown. It can rot underneath the soil, and that will destroy your strawberry plants. So, unlike asparagus where you do want to bury the crown. You absolutely do. So they're the exact opposite. First thing you want to do is you want to dig a little bit of a hole in here, set the soil aside, and then have a mound right in the center, lower than the ground level. Okay? And then some gardeners will show you. You just throw them in here and throw the dirt on. Well, that may work, but these roots were not meant to just lay on the side like that. You want to spread them out so they can start growing out. You want them to grow in all different directions. So what we're doing is we're spreading these roots out like a little octopus, set it right on top of the hill, hold it in place, and then bring in the soil. But make sure these roots aren't pointing up. That's why we plant them on a mound, so that they're pointing down. And then we start putting soil around the perimeter and working our way up to the crown. It's just that simple, folks. Now, you want to bury it right up to the crown, just like that. And make sure the roots are buried, because you want to, ooh, what on earth is this and why is it in my bag? It's a shelf bracket. How on earth did this even get here? I don't have shelves that use brackets. Oh, that's weird. Okay, that's really strange. Let's play What's in Ray's Garden Today. Anyway, when you're done, you're going to want to make sure that the ground is level, okay? And that is all there is. You want to give it a light watering with a hose to soak it all the way down below where the strawberry plant is, and then don't worry about it. Wait till the soil slightly dries out, and I don't mean just the top of it. I mean, like, you go down about maybe half a finger, and if it's dry, you water it. Other than that, leave them alone. You can mulch them, but I don't mulch mine. That's how you plant a strawberry plant. It's very, very simple, very easy, and as long as we don't have a frost, we're going to be just fine. Is it okay? Can I pet him? You don't like that, do you? No, you don't like it at all. He bum rushes the goats, and what that means is he comes running out of the house, and he runs up there, and he growls at him, and the goats, they're not afraid of him. But in his mind, he's helping me. He's trying to keep everything away from me. Hey, look, cold fingers. He thinks I have bread. I don't have any bread for you, baby. I'll come in and play later when it dries up. How's that? Okay? But anyway, that's how I plant my strawberries. And take a look at them now. It's only been, I think, about a week and a half to 2 weeks. And I want to show you what they look like now. What I think is really nice about this is I have a 100% success rate with the plants. Not one single plant died. So the planting method worked really well. And if they were going to die, they would have died by now. Because what they generally do is they'll use the energy from their roots to get going, and then their roots start growing. So they don't start growing roots right away. What they'll do is they'll use the roots to put out the greens, and then the greens fuel energy, build energy for their roots to start growing. And that's what they're doing right now. They actually got the greens going, now their roots are going, and some of them are actually starting to flower on their first season. You may or may not see this, and the choice is up to you. You can pinch those flowers off and force your plants to put out more green growth and establish themselves better, or you can allow them to flower. I generally like to pinch off the flowers the first year because they're really not going to put out a great crop, but this year, since I got such an early start and they're going to grow a lot longer before the frost gets here, I think I'm going to just let them go. And this is about the same time you're going to be getting your asparagus roots in. They're going to look dead just the same way as strawberry roots. But unlike strawberry plants, you do want to bury the crown of the asparagus underneath the soil. You definitely have to do that. I'm going to put a link underneath this program. Click where it says show more. Click that those words and it'll expand it, and there'll be a link there so you can see how I plant my asparagus roots. I have very good luck when it comes to asparagus, and even though I'm no expert, since I do have good luck, I think I'm comfortable enough to show you how to grow asparagus. And these ones are the roots that I transplanted last year. Take a look at this, and I'll put my hand here for a demonstration on the size of these. They're actually really good size, and we've got more of them coming up here. With the cool weather, you'll notice the asparagus roots start coming up, and normally I would harvest my asparagus, but since I clipped the roots when I transplanted these, their roots are not established, so I'm treating these as new plants. I'm going to wait until next year to harvest these, but I want to show you the other beds of asparagus, okay? The other two beds, check this out. With the early spraying, the asparagus beds here came out a lot earlier than they generally do. I want to go over to this one because this one has more asparagus. These are up to my chin, almost up to my chin here. These are the asparagus plants. I didn't harvest any of them because this is a younger bed, and I want to give it a couple years to establish before I start harvesting them. See all the new shoots coming out? Each cluster is a cluster of roots, and generally I don't plant my asparagus that close, but I was kind of cut for space, and I wasn't ready for these to arrive. Somebody sent me these as a gift, and I had too many roots, so I had to do what I had to do. And these are planted closer together, whereas the long bed that I just showed you, they're planted a little bit farther apart. So these will never get quite as beautiful as the other ones, but they're still going to produce nicely. But with the earlier season, I got some really great growth on these, and I'm really very happy with it. But what I did is in the spring, as soon as they start growing, I put in a layer of compost, and that's what this dark stuff is right here. This is the finished compost. It's all bulky and clumpy, and I mentioned my compost doesn't look like the stuff in the pictures. It's just functional. That's what it is. It's not beautiful, but it does work. And I just lay on about a couple inches of compost every spring, and that feeds your plants, because asparagus are energy hogs. They will suck the life right out of your soil. So every single year, if you possibly can, put in a layer of like maybe an inch or so of compost right on top of it, right up to the plants. It doesn't hurt them at all as long as you have finished compost, and they're really going to appreciate that. You know, these started to flower early, and we had the cold weather and the strong winds, so it blew the flowers off of these. So I don't believe I'm going to get any production this year, but that's okay. That's okay. I generally don't try to force my young trees. These are young trees. These were planted last year. And I don't force my trees to produce early. I like to give them a few years to start growing and getting their roots settled in and getting their branches settled in before they start producing. My peach tree on the end, it just came with peaches, so I really had no choice. And that was a nice little surprise. But this one here was a bare root stock tree that was sent to me. It was this itty bitty stick, and if you look on my videos from last year, I don't know which one it was. It was this itty bitty stick that I planted, and it's gone just beautiful. It's got a nice spread, it's got nice leaves, and that's from giving it the good soil mix that I showed you on planting the cherry trees. That's what I did with this, and I let the grass grow right up to the plants. I don't put any kind of mulch or anything there, or rocks or anything like that. But what I do, and what I'm gonna do, what the heck was that? Rascal all of a sudden jumped up. We got a pheasant that lives in one of these pine trees, and it scared the living daylights out of me. Mike and I were walking down to the other garden. I just finished off doing the fencing. And by the way, I'm going to show you the new garden next week. On next week's episode, I'm going to show you the planting of the new garden. It's beautiful. It looks nothing like you saw it the last time, okay? So tune in next week. I want to show you that. But we were walking down to that garden, and we heard this weird sound coming out of the tree. We didn't know what it was, and Rascal was looking all over the place. All of a sudden, a pheasant, a male pheasant, flew off the top of one of our trees and just took off and sailed across the fields. And it was the most beautiful thing. And the only thing I could think of is I wish I could show you guys, because it was just exquisite. This colorful creature just went and just sailed off into the sunset. It was beautiful. But anyway, I have a little bit of compost left over. I mixed the compost in with the soil and filled up the beds, but I have just enough left over. And when you have your small trees, what I recommend is feeding them every spring. So I'm going to come along with compost and lay a ring about maybe 2 feet out from these trees on top of the grass. And it's not to smother off the grass or anything, it's to feed the plant. And that's what it's going to do. As it rains and as you water, the nutrients from that rich compost are going to go down and feed that tree, and we're going to get growth. Since we're not worried about production right now, my focus is getting this to be nice and strong and healthy, and feeding it is the one thing that I want to do, because trees definitely need to be fed, just like any other plant. The soil may have good stuff in it, but you want to make sure that you feed them, because this is a permanent thing. They're bringing up stuff from the soil, they're putting it out here, and eventually they're going to use up stuff there. Yeah, their roots are growing down, but it's also a good thing to keep them fed, because you know the soil isn't this bottomless pit of good stuff. You do have to take care of your plants, okay? So putting in some compost around your trees, that's a good place to put all your excess compost. That's a great thing. So I want to be doing that with these. I just wanted to show you these because they're doing really kind of nice. This is going to look good, even though it's close to my house. I have this all planned out. I'm going to prune these and keep them shaped up so they don't go like really crazy over the top of my house and fall down and break my roof or anything. But it's nice to keep the deer away. I keep these close to the house because the deer don't come up too close to my house. He's wet. My fingers are froze solid. It's a cold morning this morning. It's like in the, I don't know, the 40s or something like that. That doesn't sound very cold, but when you're out here and it's blowing and it's kind of cold and kind of wet and stuff, your fingers tend to get a little bit. I'm just old. I'm old and I'm griping. This is actually one of my favorite spots right here. When it's not quite so wet, I sit down on here and I just enjoy the view. You can look out over, right behind you is that downhill area. I can see the garden. I can see the birds in the morning, the rolling hills, and the sun come up. And I just sit out here. I sit out here with my cup of coffee, and I'm not going to sit now because it rained. And the robins come out when it rains and they look for worms. The only problem is the robins sit here and they poop all over my stump. So yeah, I don't want to put my butt in bird poop. So I'm going to have to wait till after it rains again and then dries out, and then I'm going to sit out here with Rascal. Rascal's out there chasing all kinds of weird stuff. He's having a good time. Anyway, that was just the episode. Just a short thing to show you how I plant my strawberries and talk about asparagus. If you have any questions concerning asparagus or strawberries, post them in the comments section below. I'll be more than happy to answer your questions. And also, if you want to see how I plant and grow asparagus, I'm going to find as many links to my programs as I can about planting and growing asparagus and strawberries. And I did start strawberries indoors once, and I grew them indoors, and they grew exceptionally fast because it was warmer, the conditions were better. It's been cooler out here, so my strawberries are kind of slow, but I got some indoors that I grew. I'll put the link down there. And although I don't have any kind of rhyme or reason to my programs or any kind of order, from now on, whenever I think of something, like when I'm talking about it, if I can think about it, I'll put a link underneath. And that way it'll help you a little bit so you can see the programs that I'm talking about when I talk about things that you may not have seen, okay? That's the best way I can figure out to help you with your garden, is to just post a link so that maybe you can check out the program for yourself and see what I'm talking about. Okay, anyway, but if you do have any questions concerning your early spring garden, post it in the comment section below. I'll give you the best possible answer I possibly can. And until next week. Oh, by the way, don't forget, next week we go down to the garden. It's going to be fun. I got to mow because with all this grass, it's kind of out of control down there. It's kind of embarrassing. I'll take care of that, okay? I'll clean the place up. You just show up next week and we'll go down and we'll see the other garden. How's that sound? Okay, everybody, thank you for joining me on the farm. I really do appreciate it. Until next week, have a great day. Gotta find my Rascal. He's gone. He's a soggy mess too. And then he gets all wet, and the first thing he does is he runs into the house, and then he sits on my bed and then curls up on my pillow. And I got this muddy pillow, and I gotta keep changing the freaking pillowcase. Little piglet, little gross, dirty piglet.